All right. Well, sorry, good morning. I actually don't need quite that much volume. Maybe Kate does. This is Kate Chapman. We have the pleasure of hearing from her about land matters, creating open technology for land rights. She is the CTO of the Cadasta Foundation. Please welcome her with your applause.
Thank you, everyone. First, I'm going to start with some background. What does land matters or land rights, property rights, those what are basic terms now in the land administration industry, which I've been thrown into, but most of you probably aren't familiar with. So what do I mean when I say land matters? I'm talking about property rights and land rights. And I'm not talking about intellectual property rights. I'm talking about physical property that you go live on, farm on, maybe waterways you fish on, those sorts of things. So let's imagine a scenario. Let's imagine you're a resident of an informal settlement. And think about how you might make decisions about your life. Would you decide to build your house so it could withstand a typhoon if you might get evicted tomorrow? Would you farm your land in a sustainable way if, once again, it might not be yours tomorrow? Could you get access to credit? Does that property count as collateral since you don't have any legal documents proving? Let's say you tried to get a national identity card. Maybe you don't have an address. Maybe you have no proof of who you are. Maybe your next door neighbor and you argue about which area is yours and which is theirs because it is not delineated. There's never been a discussion about it before. So all these things affect people all over the world. There's a lot of zombie statistics floating around. It's somewhere between 70% of the world's population and a third of the world's population do not have secure rights to the land that they live on. So most of us, if not all of us, are geeks here. So how can tech fix that? It really can't. It can help a little anyway. So we're a small part of a larger system, which includes the communities who are trying to obtain recognition in their land, the governments that currently don't recognize those rights, other non-governmental organizations, individuals, businesses. It really can be pretty much everyone. And I wanted to give a little bit of the Cadasta background. There's a little splash of LCA in it. So 2 years ago, I was actually executive director of the Humanitarian OpenStreetMap team. You may remember me from previous LCAs talking about using OpenStreetMap for disaster preparedness and response. I ran a humanitarian mini-conf at the LCA in Auckland, and I invited an individual, Noel Taylor, to speak about this great land rights project he was starting. I didn't know that he agreed because he needed a CTO desperately, not because he was super excited to come speak with me on my panel. So that was when I began to find out about the Cadasta mission. So Noel and our other founder, Frank Pichel, used to work in large proprietary information systems around land registration. And donors would pay millions of dollars for these systems. They would put them in place, and the donor money would go away. The systems would be too complicated to maintain. Staff of the government would go get other jobs because all of a sudden they were tech savvy. And the records would go out of date. They found the projects that were more successful were small and community-based, and they really had much more impact. So this is how Cadasta came about. Could we focus on those small community-based projects and also use free and open source software to help these communities get legal rights to their land through recording it? So as I said, we're doing this to support those communities and individual citizens. We don't actually go and get them a legal title. We're helping with the documentation. So if you haven't recorded your land boundaries or other documents, which could be anything from a video of your neighbor saying, this is Joe, he's lived next door for 20 years, to a note that maybe a relative wrote you a note saying, when I pass away, this is your land, anything that could help prove that. And so we sit at the middle providing technology. A lot of our partners have been working in land rights for decades, but they don't use tech. They have giant stacks of paper. Maybe they're using a spreadsheet, maybe. And so we're helping facilitate that. So I hinted at this a little bit. We talk about the land rights continuum. And what that means is the communities I've been talking about have informal land rights. They live somewhere. Maybe they're allowed to. Maybe they won't get evicted. But they don't have that piece of paper that says it's theirs. And so we try to move them along the spectrum from no rights to maybe some level of rights. And there's lots of different steps along the way. And this can be anything from customary land, which is a situation, for example, where you have a tribe and they have defined boundaries that have been there for longer than perhaps the government who oversees them, all the way to an individual having a title. But we don't try to necessarily dictate what their land rights means. We just help them with technology move along to where they can be more secure and receive some of those benefits of having some level of secure land rights. We believe very much in open, and that's both open technology and open data. So the software that we build is completely free and open. You can go see what we're doing today. This is not a wild idea for many of the people in the room, but most of the people I work with, the fact that you can see what my team did today is mind-blowing. There's a lot of proprietary software, but then there's a lot of FOSS software where it's more the type where you do all the coding behind the wall and then like throw it over the fence and say, here's our release. And you try to install the software and you go, oh, this doesn't work, I'll go file a bug. And you're like, oh, someone else filed this bug a year ago, I guess. You know, we want to be in the open, we want people to help us. It's not just about the idea of free software, it's also about community. So when I say open data, I don't mean all the data we collect is open. The communities have the rights to the data they collect. It's in our terms of service. We don't own the data. We spend a lot of time going back and forth with lawyers to make this explicit. We have a role-based security model, so groups can decide if they want a little bit of their data to be accessible, do they want others to be able to edit it, and everything in between. So, this is, of course, a gross simplification, but basically, we don't care what people use to get data in. And what that means is we work with things like paper maps, we work with expensive survey equipment, drones, and then mobile phones. And if people come up with other ways of collecting data that are useful to them, we would go ahead and try to work with those as well. So, other than that we're using tech for good, which I think is exciting, we also release libraries that might be exciting to you outside of what we're doing. So I just wanted to highlight some of the software we release. So when we start adding a feature, we think through, you know, how to make it modular, pretty common things, but also hopefully someone else wants to use it. So this is all on GitHub at Cadasta. So we have our core platform code, which is the Django web app, which you can use to manage data with a geographic aspect to it. But then some of these other things, we didn't see within Django things that did quite what we needed. So we use Postgres and PostGIS, and JSON management within Postgres is relatively new, and there wasn't really a great Django plugin for doing that management. And we store the data people collect as JSON, because we allow people to define what type of data they collect. So that didn't really exist in a way that was useful to us. So we developed that and hope that others will find it useful. We also released a S3 storage library. Similar reason, didn't quite work for our purposes. But then, last but not least, the thing I'm most excited about is we have Django tutelary, which is role-based permissions, which allows you could implement it to give people individual attribute permissions. Right now, we do it at essentially if you think about a database table, at the row. So you can say, you have access to this row of data, but not that one. So you can imagine, if you're collecting property rights data, maybe you don't want everyone in your collecting data to have access to everything. So this is very, very important to us. So we developed this for our own purposes, but I'm hoping that someone else thinks that's exciting at some point. Because in Tech for Good, I've gone to a lot of hackathons, and people seem to think that developers are just waiting for people to want to help, you know? And what I mean by that is I've gone to a lot of disaster response hackathons, and they're like, oh, well, I have my idea. I was hoping you'd code on it. And I don't expect people to come contribute code to Cadasta just because you think what we're doing is cool. I mean, that would be great. But my hope is by providing things that might be useful in your own projects, you'll test, and perhaps we get some issues or bug fixes and things that way, which is, at least within the area of Tech for Good I work on, is very different, because a lot of groups go, well, these developers, they won't come do what I tell them to do. It's like, well, we're trying to engage you and make it interesting and compelling. So some of what I described, it might have sounded like we make all our own stuff and, you know, don't reuse other libraries. Not true. We also believe in contributing to what works. So these are just a few things that we use every day that works. As I mentioned, my background is OpenStreetMap, so I was very excited that we could participate in OpenStreetMap. We use the OpenStreetMap data as a basis, our base map. We also participate in the Missing Maps Project, which is a project, a consortium of organizations that contribute to OpenStreetMap to help map vulnerable people. And so we participate as part of that consortium. And then these other items are all things we use in our core platform. Well, that would say pen and paper if it was formatted correctly. Anyway, another piece of software you might not have heard of is called Field Papers. If you go to fieldpapers.org, you can see how it works. And what Field Papers does is it allows you to print a map, and then it has a QR code and markings on it. You can take that map out and go with pen and annotate it. Once you're done collecting those annotations, you can take a picture of it with your mobile phone, and then you upload it to the Field Papers server. And what that does is it takes that scan and it geo-rectifies it. So typically what happens when you use paper maps in GIS systems is you have your paper map and you go draw on it, you upload it, and then someone has to create reference points to match it so that it's geospatial. This does it automatically, so it skips an entire step in that process. We're still integrating field papers directly into our system and our workflow, but we've been contributing bug fixes, as well as we sponsored an outreachy intern last year, and she worked on this and improved the interface because it hadn't gotten attention in a few years. And just a reminder for what outreachy is, it's a paid internships for underrepresented groups in free and open source software. And so that was how we did a lot of this work, and Lindsay Jacks, our intern, works for us full time today as well. We also work a lot with OpenDataKit and GeoODK. So what OpenDataKit is it's a system for offline mobile data collection. And it's both an Android application and a web platform. And so we extensively use the Android application to collect data. Because what it lets you do is using XLS forms, which you can edit in any spreadsheet, define your data attributes, upload them to a server, and then download that as a form to your phone so you can go then collect data. Currently we're adding a very minor thing to this, which I'm very excited about. You can't send custom error messages to the mobile apps, ODK or GeoODK. You just get a generic one. So when you're trying to troubleshoot something, you have no idea what's going on. So we're adding just the ability to send custom error messages. It was already available in the specification. The phone just couldn't receive them. So I talked a bit about our technology, but not really what we were doing with it. So we have a few different partners. So we've been working with this group, Namati. They do legal empowerment for the poor in a few countries around the world. And their land rights group's been around for 7 years. And they've been doing this all through paper. So what we've been doing is we've been training them in how to use satellite imagery, mobile apps, as well as our web software to collect data so that it stays safe, it's backed up, and when they update it, they don't have to start again. And myself and our product manager attended their annual community facilitator meeting in Nairobi a few months ago. And it's great to be able to teach people technology, but then I learned a lot about community building that I hadn't thought about. You know, we don't always think about that. And some of it was just from icebreakers I've never heard of, to different ways to discuss problems. And so as a technologist, it was really a privilege that I got to just be like, oh, I can help you with this data thing, but I'm learning from you as well. So they're one of our key partners for providing feedback and helping us develop things. We also did a project with the Kosovo Cadastral Agency. So the World Bank and the Cadastral Agency had flown a lot of drone footage, but they weren't really sure how they were going to use it. So what we did is we went and helped them use field papers and ODK with this imagery to collect data. The thing in Kosovo is there's not a clear path for women to inherit property. And in this particular village, a large portion of the men were killed in the war in 1999. And so now years have gone by, and people have almost default rights to the property because no one's come to say, oh, it's mine. But there's a lot of women living on land with no documented rights. So the goal of this was to document this information. Whether or not then at a government level they'll award those rights is, who knows, hopefully. But we're at least recording what is there. We also work with a group called the Justice Empowerment Initiative. They work in Nigeria. And what they do is they do surveys at community levels to profile the security of their land tenure in those places. And they were doing this completely with paper forms, collecting about 100 attributes of data, and then data entering it into a spreadsheet. So what we've done is help them convert that data from paper forms for 20 to 30 of those communities. And now they've started collecting information using ODK first. So speeding up their overall data management process. We've also worked in Bangladesh, been working in Bangladesh and in India. In Bangladesh, they had begun using ODK a little bit, but we're helping them be a bit more efficient and providing storage and management of that data. And then Landesa has been around 30 years, and so they started working in India to help provide legal empowerment around land rights to the rural poor. They don't really use tech at all, and if you look up their site, they've won many, many awards. They have some amazing advisors and people on their board of directors, a really high impact group, but it's all on paper. And so what we've been doing is currently they go out with paper forms, once again use a spreadsheet, and then they manually look for mistakes in people's land titles. So an example of such a mistake is, let's say you go walk a property with a GPS and it says, oh, this is 2 acres of land. Sometimes the title says, oh, you only have 0.2 acres of land. And so looking for those types of mistakes, and then there's a process to actually apply to the government to get that fixed. They found in some villages 90% of the titles in those places had mistakes. So we're helping to speed the process up and allow people to get those corrections in a more timely fashion. So some of you might want to get involved. So there's a couple different ways that that can happen. Use our code, as I mentioned. We love it when people do that. Use our platform. So we have a demo site up. You can go do whatever you want on it. It's a demo site. From a data perspective, we collect people's relationship to land. That can mean a lot of things. For example, in Portland, Oregon, where I live, if I stop traveling so much, I'll be home next month for a bit. There's a lot of fruit trees. And you can imagine recording whether or not you can go pick the fruit from those trees. And there's a proprietary website where you can do that, but there's nothing really crowdsourced out there. And so that's an example of something that you might not think about it being land rights, but it is. I briefly was mapping Pokestops, but it seems like other people have taken that over now. But there's lots of different things you can possibly do. So as I mentioned, Outreachy, currently we have 2 interns working with us. So we help people get started in free and open source software. So if you know someone who would be a good intern who wants to do a 12-week paid internship, we're planning to do that again in the next round. We like patches, of course. And if you have some other idea, come let me know. We're a small group. There's 15 of us, so we at least have some ability to think creatively, I hope. I wish I could say we were hiring for more devs, but we just wrapped up hiring one. But keep an eye out. We sometimes have positions out there. Thank you. Just to mention, how do we get to do all this stuff? We're supported by UK Aid, and the Omidyar Network is what allows us to both build our software and help our partners. And so that's been really crucial to what we do. And if there's any questions. there's other libraries that are part of the, that integrate with ODK. There's one that allows you to take those XLS forms and create a, have a form on a web page with it. And I'm sure there's others that I, that we haven't used. One of the things that's been a bit interesting with ODK, it has a lot of forks, which under a lot of different names. And I think part of that is they're currently moving out of a university and trying to figure out how to have a better community. And so there's a lot of different pieces that are based on ODK that do things in different ways. We're using the core ODK. There's also one called Form Hub, which has a bit better form data entry. And I think you can print forms as well. So there's a lot of things out there that are part of the ecosystem, but because it's hard to keep track of because it's so well forked, we'll say.
I don't know how much you probably are aware of the land rights movement in Australia. And more generally, that sort of, there's words here. Kind of applying sort of Western models of land ownership in sort of more like, developing countries, but where, you know, the use of the land is sort of different and doesn't fit that. I can't figure out what my question is. Is that enough words to
I think I can
intuit?
Put some words out there.
Yeah, thanks.
We focus on people's relationship to the land, and we've tried to build a very flexible model to allow that. If people are really into ISO standards, there's the land administration domain model, which is 180 pages, that outlines all the relationships people could have to their land. And we sort of looked at that, but then did something much more simple. So for example, some of the groups we work with are forest people. So they have, you know, the boundary of their traditional lands and then their different uses. Some groups are pastoralists, so time has an aspect as well. We're definitely cognizant that we don't want to force our primarily Western values on these groups. We're more trying to, you know, listen and figure out what they're trying to do and helping facilitate that. It definitely is challenging. You can tell if you look at the LATAM, the standard I mentioned, that people spend a lot of time trying to think of every possible scenario. And we've just tried to be flexible and hope it covers what people need to do and we can adjust.
Thanks for that, Kate. I'm super interested in the organization and things like what's the kind of revenue and how big the team, what type of people on the team, or what do they do, and all of that.
Sure. The majority of our money comes from grants from these two groups. We are funded. I like to think of us funded as a startup, but as a nonprofit. So, you know, if you took venture capital, you'd need to return money. We need to return good instead. And so that's how we're, that's primarily how we're funded. The one thing similar that also goes with sort of the startup parallel is part of that initial funding was to think through what the different models for continuing to raise funds would be. As far as the team, there's 15 of us. We're spread out all over the world. We all work remotely. My team is myself and 7 people, the tech team, so developers, DevOps, and then we have a programs team that go actually travel to some of these places and work with people, and then sort of the normal administrative roles any organization needs as well.
Mm-hmm. Hi. Who assigns the roles for accessing and changing the data? How's that process managed?
Assigns the roles? Yeah, so at the moment, the majority of the groups we work with, we're working directly with them. And they decide the roles. I would say our team sometimes probably helps them walk through thinking about that from a technical perspective, but they have the rights to do it. Our goal isn't to go shake hands with everyone who uses our software forever. And in those cases, you know, we wouldn't have access to the data. Someone could set up a project on our platform, assign roles, and manage it all themselves. But that's not the reality of what happens today.
So Deb may yank the mic out of my hand because I'm going to bend the conference rules a little bit because I don't actually have a question, but it's a statement of great gratitude. I want to tell you that I think it's wonderful that you're using free software to impact another social justice cause. And I hope that's okay. I know it's not a question, but thank you.
Thanks, Bradley.
That's okay.
Just as far as the slums transitioning to private property ownership, are there governments who are far down the track of actually doing that? Can you cite some examples of you know, large scale title creation?
I don't know if I can cite a specific example. What happens, which is probably not surprising, is, you know, laws vary in every country that we work in related to property rights. In some places, there's laws in place where if you pay taxes for X period of time, you can get legal rights to that land, which is an interesting incentive for people to pay taxes. In other places, having proof of utility bills and things like that can do it. I don't have a great example of a large-scale titling. No one's asked me that before, but I certainly will be quizzing my land buddies, Frank and Noel, who are subject matter experts, because they've talked about it in more rural areas quite extensively, and I'm sure it's there's examples in informal settlements as well. I just can't speak to a specific example.
Hi, me again. This is my other question, which is a bit more gnarly and kind of philosophical. And I'm wondering whether you specifically, or your organization, I guess, has an opinion on this, and I think you do, but you mentioned that 70% of the world's population potentially doesn't have land rights, and this project seems predicated on the idea that land rights is a good thing. But if most of the world doesn't have land rights, is it a good thing? Like, are you actually working towards a world where we assert rights over land, which, like, is that a good thing? Or is there maybe an anti-project that exists that says, like, let's stop having land rights, let's delete the 30% of land rights?
Is that parallel to, let's not license our software, copyright shouldn't exist, maybe? you know, there's individual land rights, there's communal land rights, and various other models. And I can say I personally don't think the answer is to get everyone their own little square of property. There is some research behind people are more equipped to. So when I was in Kenya with these community land protection facilitators, they were telling stories about what happens when investors come, because that's going to happen. And in one group in Liberia, they have a hotline. So if an investor shows up, you call this number and say, hey, this guy is trying to get us to sign this document, and they essentially send out a lawyer. What's helpful in those scenarios is those communities have walked through what their community bylaws are, what's okay, what their community norms are. And So as part of that, they're not figuring all that out when the investor comes and is like, can you sign this today? I'll give you this small pile of money. And so it actually can help them protect the rights to have this communal land instead of it ending up owned by one corporation or one individual. And there's some other social benefits as well. One group was talking about how these processes can also help protect the rights of women as well. So community starts talking about their rules, and someone says, maybe we shouldn't beat our wives. This is a discussion. And someone was anecdotally telling a story that this guy was well known for beating his wife consistently. And so people started calling him by the number of the rule, like calling him rule number 8. And it actually led to him to stop doing this because there was that community pressure. So it's complicated, basically.
Other questions and anything that folks have not gotten to? Okay.
Since we've got a bit of time left, could you talk a bit about your Kenya experience and the community and how they were interacting?
Sure. So I was actually with community land rights facilitators. So Namati, our partner, brings their groups from all over the world together to discuss these projects. So what I said about, for example, the group that had the hotline, that's one example. Other things we went over was, it's interesting to start thinking about how do you evaluate the success of your project as well, if you were, well, I'm pretty data focused, but how do you evaluate it if you're in an absence of a lot of data? So talking through, you know, how would you measure the results, which could be in places where governments have, there is communal land rights, there is a way to apply to the government. They were recording, you know, the timing from initially working on bylaws to reviewing those bylaws to doing mapping to applying to the government. And what was that time frame? And looking at, and they were also looking at diversity within that. If there's different ethnicities and religions and gender and things like that. So there was a whole day about monitoring and evaluation and how it applies to these projects. And sort of just the different ways that people try to, you know, get communities involved and then help them. In a lot of cases, they're facing encroachment typically it seems it's actually rich individuals in the countries that they're in, but sometimes, because you can imagine a multinational corporation, not to say they don't do terrible things, but there's different pressure that can be put on them than one rich individual who's local to that place as well.
Any other questions?
Yeah. Have you seen any examples yet where this work has been able to, you know, stop a developer just coming in and taking it, or government saying, no, no, you don't have rights to be here? Have you got some of those stories?
We, as an organization, haven't yet. Some of it's I think a matter of time. You know, it's one of those things. It's sort of like disaster recovery systems. You know, you don't really get credit if things never go down and everything works perfectly. But I think it's a matter of time we'll start to see that. I should mention we're 2 years old. We released our first release of this Django-based platform that we've built happened just in July of last year. And previous to that, we were using sort of a prototype, which just started January last year. So basically, we've been doing this a year. So over time, I think we'll definitely have more of those stories. At the moment, it's more, well, people were already doing this and they got great results. How do we amplify that? One of the things we're fortunate to have is a great designer, so I don't do my own slides really anymore. So,
I have a question. So you've got the two grant-making organizations. Do you also have a roster of individual donors that give money to make Cadasta go?
Not yet. Have we received individual donations occasionally? One of the things that we've thinking through for us, you know, a lot of the groups we work with have large individual donor bases because they're doing this very impactful work, and I think what we're doing is very important. But how to communicate this, that we're amplifying with technology what these groups are doing, you know, we haven't done much with that. Part of that is, to allude back to what Donna was asking, is how to, you know, show that impact to inspire people to donate.
It's really awesome to hear from somebody who's working on free and open source software for a not-for-profit organization where the kind of purpose of the organization isn't necessarily to sustain the project, if you know what I mean. Like, you are working on these to help these people with their land rights and get their data. I don't think there's that many people in the world working on projects like that. And so I'm just really interested to hear about what that kind of means to you as a, you know, somebody working on tech and kind of your story of how you got into that world.
Sure. I'm a geographer. So I learned to program when I was 10, but then I went to school for geography. So I've always sort of worked in tech and geography. And so in 2010, OpenStreetMap was just a hobby for me. And there was the earthquake in Haiti, and people just started mapping, and I was one of them. And what rolled out of that was a group of us founded the humanitarian OpenStreetMap team and started teaching people OpenStreetMap for disaster preparedness and response. And so I had always worked for for-profit tech companies. Some of it was open, some was not. And realized, oh, I could do this full time. And so my work at HOT, we also weren't necessarily sustaining the OpenStreetMap project. Like, we contributed to it, but we weren't the core thing to sustain the project. And then when this opportunity at Cadasta came around, that was one of the things I was attracted to, because it's this opportunity to work on FOSS software, which is really great, but also have some more of sort of the structure outside of FOSS, you know, where we run more like an NGO nonprofit than necessarily a FOSS nonprofit foundation most of the time. And things like that are, well, my whole team, I hired them and built the team, because we weren't coming out of a movement and adding a foundation to it. We were trying to start a movement. And so it's been a bit different because it allows you to think through things. Like, for example, my comment on not making my slides, we could say, oh, we should have a graphic designer and do that as part of planning to create it, rather than thinking, how do we get someone to come make the thing we already did look better? So it's been exciting to have that planning and thought that you don't always get to get in other projects.
I'm sorry, we're out of time. Everyone, thanks so much, Kate, for your talk and your amazing work.
Thank you, everyone.